hostility without actually not doing anything. Hostility by not doing anything.
Well, we're jumping in a little bit, but let me just tell you more story.
Okay.
This child fell, and what made the situation negligent was the response of the staff.
Right.
When he fell and hit his head, I immediately ran over. There was blood everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
In a sense, I panicked because of the tremendous amount of blood that he was losing at the time.
Mm-hmm.
As I began to try to hold the child, and I saw that he was resistant because he was scared.
Right.
You know, he was afraid of, you know, the blood that he saw.
Mm-hmm.
I began to call for help. Because there was a combined gym, there were several other staff members there.
Right.
There were other teachers there, other aides there, mm-hmm. that should have immediately responded and mm-hmm. come over to assist me.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't.
Right.
They stood there, they looked. So I called for help again. No one came again. The substitute teacher finally responded. She ran over and got me some gloves.
Mm-hmm.
But my pain was caused because the fact that everyone stood there watching.
How long did they stand
there? I would say it was at least 3 to 5 minutes before anyone came. And when someone finally did come, it was because I called her in particular.
Okay.
You know, I began to then call names.
So that's just one person came after that.
And right.
You called one person's name.
The physical therapist came.
Yeah.
She came over. I called her by name and I said, I need you to help me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm mad, it's out of control. I can't hold him. He's afraid, sure. You know, naturally because he was losing so much blood.
Mm-hmm.
And because he probably saw that I was afraid,
right.
You know, because he was losing so much blood. Now, as I said, I have kids who have fallen and who have sustained injuries,
mm-hmm.
but never have I been in a situation where I saw a child actually losing a lot of blood,
mm-hmm.
in which and I was not in control of the situation.
Right.
So she did come over to help me, and together, her and I tried to calm this child down.
Now, not to cut you off, but how much blood do you think you lost between that 5 minutes?
I don't know.
I
don't know. All I know is that there was blood all over me.
Yeah.
There was blood all over him, blood all over the floor. There was just blood everywhere.
Right.
Now, keep in mind, not to cut you off, but keep in mind, under any situation in regular school,
sure.
as well as school for the handicapped, there's procedures that's been taught. You know, in case of any emergency or accident,
mm-hmm.
this wasn't in place when my grandson injured himself. All caution went to the wind. People stood around, just watched her struggle to stop the bleeding, to calm him down. You know,
mm-hmm.
and so then they wanted to put him on the bus and send him home with a head injury, which is against their even policy of this particular program. It's called SKIP.
Yeah.
You know, so when I was caught and notified that my grandson had sustained a head injury again, you know, then I began to inquire what was the status, how he was reacting, what
sure.
he was doing. Oh, I haven't seen him. You know, I was really shocked. Here, a professional nurse calling me, telling me that my grandson is injured, but yet she hadn't seen him.
Right.
So again, is that child safe? Are our child safe in these schools?
Right.
You know, it's a question that I would like to really the public to ask, you know, who have handicapped children, when they send them off to school, are they really safe?
Yeah.
You know,
see, that's the whole issue. If they're not, if the people with the staff, they don't care, then
mm-hmm.
right there, your kid's going to school with strikes against them.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? If the staff doesn't care, your kid's going to school right after that with strikes against them, so they're not safe.
Exactly.
You're sending them into an unsafe environment.
Exactly.
So, you know, there's no reason for staff to not care.
Mm-hmm.
If they claim that they want to be there to help students and everything,
mm-hmm.
they're well-trained, supposedly.
Yeah.
We hope to do these jobs.
And even more so important, these are children who have special needs. These are children who cannot communicate.
Right.
They can't talk.
Right.
They can't tell you, I'm aching, I'm hurt.
Right.
So you should be all the more concerned, you know, as far as that child's needs go. These particular staff members all stood there and watched, and immediately I felt pain. Immediately
mm-hmm.
tears came to my eyes because I knew that everyone is standing there watching because, oh, they don't want to get any blood.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. These are people that work with this child every day.
Now, what we're going to do before we go into these messages, we're going to deal with more of the attitude of the staff members and your exchange with them. But right now, we've got to go and pay bills.
He was only 15 years old, man. You know, skinny little dude, you know. And some grown guys, man, some big kids, you know, walked up on him and shot him 7 times. You know, he was a little frail body person, you know, and it took his life, you know. We went to his funeral, and I seen him up in there. It was like I seen him yesterday, like, dang, man, he gone? You know, I don't want that to be me, you know. So I left that alone, you know. So that's what really made me want to get up out this game.
Thank you for staying with Point Blank. Once again, we're dealing with this issue dealing relating to the Heritage Educational Center. And we were talking mostly with Ms. Sherice Tyes. Ms. Tyes, a former employee of the center. And she was, giving us her version of a very horrible incident that happened with one of the students there. And you were talking about the contact with the staff, of course, and your exchange with them.
Right, right. During this incident, once I finally did get a staff member to respond and to help me, we together still could not hold this child. So, meanwhile, the occupational therapist comes in, and I look to him and I say, Mr. Bob, could you come over and assist us? We need help. First of all, I never should have asked anyone to come over and assist me, because immediately when you see trouble, you respond. Just in human nature, you don't have to be trained to respond. You know to respond. I said, could you come over and assist us? He told me no. He said, no, I have to go and call the nurse. So I had a big problem with that immediately while still trying to control and help this child. The nurse now, she works at another location.
Right.
Anytime there's an injury or an emergency, we were always trained.
Was she the head nurse?
Yes, she's the head nurse. We were always told to contact the nurse. That okay. We would first have to, you know, control the situation, of course,
right.
But then call the nurse so that she can come over and assess the injury. So we finally got the child calm. We proceeded to take him upstairs to find out what the nurse had said to do, and to change his clothes and things like that. So I get upstairs, I asked Mr. Bob, I said, well, what did the nurse say? He looked and he said the nurse said to put him on the bus and send him home. Well, immediately I had a problem with that, because number one, the nurse's job, she knew there was a head injury. In my opinion, her job was to come over there and check the child out.
Right.
Make sure he's safe. Make sure he doesn't have a concussion.
Yeah.
Make sure that he hasn't lost too much blood. Make sure.
You think maybe the nurse is thinking about other issues like lawsuits or health care
or the nurse just did
she
not
just didn't care.
Because previous to this, we had another incident with this same child where we addressed some concerns,
okay.
And the same nurse told us basically to handle it ourselves. So, you know, I haven't worked for them long, but apparently there's been some ongoing problems with this particular nurse where employees have addressed concerns, but nothing has been done.
Right.
So, I think it was just the parent within me that told me, listen, no, I'm not going to put this child on the bus. I'm not a medical doctor. I don't know whether he needs medical attention. And because I was the one attending to this child, I felt as though he did. That's when I called Ms. Ramahdan. I told her, you know, that her son had fell in his head, lost a lot of blood. I felt as though he needed medical attention, but the nurse was saying to put him on the bus and send him home.
Right.
And she had not even seen him.
Right.
Meanwhile, she had gave Ms. Ramahdan the impression that she had checked the child out.
Right.
Because she had placed the call to her to let her know that, you know. So after that, things just blew up and got out of control.
Right.
I spoke to the nurse because I was told that I had to call the nurse back to tell her that Ms. Ramahdan had said, well, if you feel as though he needs medical attention, then call me anyway. When I called the nurse back, there was immediate confrontation. She started yelling and screaming at me, how dare me go over her head. Her concern was...
Now, where does she get the right to yell and raise her voice to you?
Right. She had no right. Her concern was never the child.
Right.
Her concern was why did I, who was beneath her,
yeah.
call the grandmother.
Now, she said, now, this is a telltale thing. I remember you sent me a report that she felt you went over her head.
Right.
For the grandmother.
She said, how dare I go over her head and call
her. Yeah, now that's only natural. It's natural to do that.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So, you know, that's a very unfortunate incident. But I want to go to her right quick. But you have any other closing thoughts or any impressions about
I just
that,
would
that
like
incident?
To say to parents out there, be very careful and be very involved with your children when they go to school. Be on top of who's caring.
Yeah.
Check their histories, check their backgrounds, because you never know. It was a nightmare that I walked into and discovered. And it has definitely made me think about where I send my children and think about whose hands they're in when I leave them.
Okay. Ms. Ramahdan, mm-hmm. I wanted to talk about, you had some points relating to what should happen.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much along lines with her as far as your impressions of healthcare.
Well, I'm taking my grandchild back to the suburbs, you know. But I can't go with thinking without speaking out against the children and parents that can't speak for themselves or who don't know what's going on. And I would hope that people who's viewing this show would write and their legislators and insist that a BOCE program, which will ensure our child with training, professionalism, teachers and therapists and so forth, that goes along with BOCE program, and visit these schools and institutions unannounced.
Sure.
And see what they see. I was shocked to see that openly that they abuse children.
And you know something, the sad part is it did happen in a city school.
Yes, sir.
But you got a lot of parents, that most of the staff members, how familiar are they with dealing with black children?
Well, I seen white children abused too.
Well, that's tragic.
Yeah.
That's horrible.
And these are children that can't speak for themselves. And briefly, you know, this country did a biography on children, orphanage children in the Ukraine and in different parts of Germany.
Right.
You've seen so much abuse. And right here in this country, we got all type of abuse. There's nobody's even addressing.
You know, with that.